This is welcome to the afternoon portion. Yep, Mr. Woodland, if you would like to...
He who must be obeyed.
Bring us...
Light and wisdom.
Yes, Your Worship. In your package, you've been provided a one-page introduction to the table and the 7 pages of some recommendations prepared regarding the governance model. The recommendations flow from discussions amongst the administration at the senior management table and are informed as well from some of the comments we got from the survey that was administered last summer. As noted in my cover report, there was an initiative to engage advisory committees in a discussion that started in September but was interrupted and did not resume prior to the commencement of the civic election process. My hope today was simply to give you an outline of these recommendations, explain some of the rationale, and then to take direction from council as to what, as Liz Watson described, what are the next steps. Some of these recommendations are mechanical. They relate to the mechanics of how we do things. Some of them bleed over into some of the issues that Liz identified in terms of getting a better understanding for council through orientation processes, additional documentation, roles, relationships, and that sort of thing. It's broken down into about 6 or 7 subject areas. I'm just going to progress through the table as it stands here. The first section of recommendations relate to the standing committee structure of council. The themes that we identified as staff from the current governance model is that three standing committees, corporate services, environment and infrastructure, community development, were not meeting with the frequency or the activity that we expected when we set the model up. A number of meetings were canceled from time to time for lack of agenda items. Sometimes agenda items were canceled after a meeting had been scheduled. So it was frustrating, I'm sure, for committee members, and staff also were struggling to get items to those agendas for their consideration. The recommendation reflects looking at that model and suggesting how could we use council's time more effectively, how could we use staff time more effectively, and a suggestion has come forward with respect to combining two of the committees and or rolling also corporate services issues up into the governance and priorities committee for the consideration of all council members. Outlines of a couple of the models are provided to you in the package, and I'll touch on those in a little bit. If we are to collapse committees, there is also a suggestion in our recommendations that you might consider expanding the membership. So, for example, in one of the models that is outlined, we go to 2 standing committees, one focused on planning and land use, one focused on services and infrastructure. You might want to balance membership so that there are 4 members of council on each committee and the mayor on both. Other recommendations related to this particular table relate to standing committee member terms. If we're going to balance membership, you might consider swapping the members over halfway through your council term so everyone gets an opportunity to share the role and the terms of reference area that comes with that role on the 2 standing committees. We also feel, and I'm going to focus just on these yellow items primarily, we also feel that we may want to set the quorum level, regardless of what model we proceed with, at 3, so that there's always at least 3 members of a committee present when decisions and recommendations are being made. That would mean that if the mayor was unable to attend a meeting and there was a council member absent, the acting mayor would be standing in the mayor's place at the meeting. We also talked about council's relationship to its standing committees and how the agenda for the standing committees is developed. And this is in relation to the public advisory committee and decisions flowing out of the public advisory committee. So we certainly support the relationship that the standing committee has with the council in terms of ideas that are recommended either the standing committee have to flow up to council, be endorsed by council before they're tasked to staff or work. How we get that into the priority setting process is something we'll need to work out in the context of these other issues that we discussed this morning with Liz. On the second page, under public input, Planning and Land Use Committee, and I think staff have struggled with this whole issue of input to the Planning and Land Use Committee for recommendations that don't have the endorsement from the staff group to move forward to public hearing or be otherwise approved. We've discussed that amongst ourselves and are suggesting that we might consider in the Planning and Land Use Committee's terms of reference simply an opportunity for the applicants to answer questions of council or of the committee when requested. That would enable the committee to ask any particular question about the application of the applicant and as well to ask the applicant regarding staff's recommendation to turn down the particular proposal. That's a minor change, but it is a change. So just focusing on the two diagrams that were provided. Again, it suggested under 1A that we retain most of the structures, council at the top, governance and priorities committee with an expanded mandate to include the corporate services issues, the agenda meeting, and I'll touch on that in a little while, two standing committees, one focused on planning and land use, one's focused on services and infrastructure, and a relationship with advisory bodies flowing to each of those. The second diagram is a variation of the first, and it just respects the relationship with the public advisory committees. And in this particular model, we don't show a public advisory committee associated with the council standing committee for services and infrastructure, but rather a generalized citizen advisory committee to the GPC that could take on any type of a task assigned to it by GPC. And I'll touch on that in a little more detail. That's just a quick outline of staff's input on the governance from the standing committee perspective. We are, you know, alive to the fact that the number of standing committees engages a greater number of staff to attend the meetings, and a greater number of people in terms of supporting the staff presentations at those types of meetings, and mindful of the limitations we have on capacity to get other things done. The next section speaks to the public advisory committees, and I'll go through the yellow sections again. Certainly one of the themes that I've encountered over the years that I've been in the city, which is about 17 years at City Hall, is there's always been a element of concern from the public advisory committee members that they're not fully utilized. Certainly I've done about three or four surveys of the public advisory committee members, and they always feel that there's more they can offer and that they're often underutilized from an advice point of view. So it's no surprise to me that public advisory committees are again saying there's more we can do, there's more we can offer. This model doesn't seem to be getting the most out of what we can offer. The public advisory committees are meant to advise council, to offer that citizen viewpoint, or in certain cases to provide a focused expertise on a specific subject. We feel strongly that the public advisory committees should work on council's priorities and not drive your priorities. In other words, council's here to decide what is the priority focus for the organization, to assign resources, to assign staff to focus on those things, not necessarily for those things to be drawn into the public advisory committee to have the public advisory committee develop and use resources. So it's simply a way to ensure that council continues to have some control over its policy agenda and the use of staff resources to support that. the question I guess we'll leave everyone with today is, if the current system isn't working, is there another approach to public advisory committees that might be more effective? And the one that comes to mind is simply using public advisory committees to focus on specific issues or specific tasks and give them a mandate and a timeline and support that enables them to carry out focus work and provide advice to council from time to time on different issues. The alternative, of course, is the standing public advisory committee model. Do we need to move to a more generalized citizens advisory committee that could provide issues to you from time to time as referred by GPC? Or do we stick with some variation of the current model where we maintain the public advisory committees in conjunction with the services and infrastructure committee and in conjunction with a planning advisory committee role with GPC? And so the first section, 1A, sort of reflects on those themes. And then 1B reflects back to the model that's labeled 1B, which just shows a narrower focus for citizen advisory committees in relation to governance and priorities committee, and then mandate specific council advisory committees and task forces convened when issues and priorities desire a public advisory committee role. In both models, we see value in maintaining the advisory design panel and the heritage advisory panel. We think they should both be renamed as panels because they are more technical focused, they are more expertise focused, and it distinguishes them from the committee, which we want to be more generalized, more advice oriented. We also need, we're also suggesting that we may want to look critically as how we recruit the advisory committee members. We may want to spend more time and effort determining the skill sets that we would like to see people apply for in some of these committees, and that's reflected in item number 4. We also think it might be beneficial to have advisory committees serve 2 terms rather than 3 consecutive terms, just to get the turnover of the people onto the new committees, try to boost the involvement of people on the committees. We do want to maintain that relationship. If there's a standing public advisory committee model that persists, that relationship with the standing committee, the standing committee still needs to endorse proposals that come from that public advisory committee. And more direct relationship with respect to how the public advisory committee does its work. And we're suggesting that should be more specifically tasked by council or GPC to make sure that council buys into the issues and the priorities that it assigns down to the public advisory committees for work. It doesn't mean that they can't come up through the standing committee, but they just need to close that loop, have all of council buy into it before work is done. Currently, the public advisory committees can generate their own discussions and their own issue reviews based on their terms of reference. In terms of the what we call currently the agenda committee, we're thinking it should simply be renamed because it really isn't a meeting. It's really a meeting. It's not a committee per se. It's meant simply to provide directional advice as to where reports go. It's not meant to hold things up. It's not meant to kill things, and it doesn't do that role. Each of the current councillors will have served on the agenda committee from time to time. But to ensure role clarity, we think that it should have some terms of reference, albeit modest. The members really are the acting mayor, the mayor, the city manager, and myself, and then others support the meeting just in terms of providing information related to the reports. So we just think there's some improvements there for role clarity. Under section D, when we're talking about external appointments, number two highlighted in yellow, we just think there may be some value in looking to external appointments where a citizen might be appointed instead of a council member. We just think that might free up councillors for time to focus on priority items. I know when George Cuff came and did a review of us in 2008, 2009, on more than one occasion he asked me, are there really this number of committees these people have to serve on? I think he was surprised at the number of cross appointments across the community that council members are expected to serve on, in addition to their statutory roles at the CRD and of course at the council table.
So Rob, for that one, if we agree with that, there'll be some discussion at a later date of what committees would.
Yes, I think we'd have to do a bit of research. You know, I think there's a few that might be available, but we'd have to go specifically look at. And, you know, I hear from time to time that some boards are looking to move towards that. I can't remember who mentioned it last, the mayor, I think GVHA maybe in its governance review might be looking towards that. We have a mix. We have a mix of boards that are dual. Where there's a council member on the library board plus four citizen representatives, council member of cemetery, and a citizen appointee as well.
I just want to say I'm looking forward to, I'm still on one. So there's going to be comments on every one of these. So my assumption is we're going to have a quick overview now, and then we're going to start walking our way through these. Is that correct?
No, I was going to ask you to do that.
Just, and if everybody's happy, just motion to approve as is. Thank you.
I get a bonus if I get them all approved.
Yes. Don't spend it.
My intention is to run through the overview and then certainly however you want to approach this. And it wasn't my expectation that there would be any final decisions today. But I did have a dream. No. Do you want to pause there? I can continue on, but if you are dwelling on section one, why don't we stop and have a discussion?
Okay.
Just a general comment that I would make is the implications and the impacts of potential decisions that we might make today are really enormous. Mm-hmm. And not having established what the connection is for engagement with folks who were on these committees and all of that, it just makes me very uncomfortable dealing with it at this level because there's so much to be heard back and forth. And so how we structure that, because today, even if we're not making decisions, we could be seemingly to sort of send things in a certain direction in our own discussion that's not informed by the feedback from committee members or however we wish to engage with that segment of the public. So that's what I'm struggling with here.
And certainly in framing this for you, I've purposefully tried to frame it as these are the recommendations that come from your staff. Mm-hmm. And we know that there was a conversation started with the public advisory committee members in a meeting with the mayor in September of last year that was interrupted, literally. I think it was a bomb threat or something. And it just didn't get reconvened, and then the election came upon us. So certainly from my perspective, we're tabling these for your consideration, for good or bad. We think there's some merit to a number of the recommendations, and then we go from there.
So it's quite recommended for council for order of procedure that we go through these. We discuss just what about this, what about that, or these are my thoughts, preliminary thoughts, with an eye that we're going to need to have reflection, our own personal reflection on all of the implications of all that. And then start to think about, okay, who do I need to talk to? Who do council need to talk to as we move forward, as opposed to making the decision on these in a final way? So to a certain extent, that would be, I think, would be ambitious for us to even get through and just say, well, here's my thoughts about this idea, and a chance for other councillors to build in. Because we do want a sense of direction of what we're going to go talk to other bodies about, so we do need some sort of idea. But I think it'd also be unwise to make a determinative decision that it's a slam dunk. And anytime it's a slam dunk, it's kind of like, okay, we missed something. Because if it's easy, we probably missed something. So recognizing that we're aiming for a 4 o'clock end for today.
That'll be page one.
Yeah, page one.
And we're here. So I just, I mean, so, and that's it, right? I mean, don't make the simple thing complex, don't make a complex thing simple. I have, so those are my thoughts as how we should proceed. I don't know if it has any relations to why Jeff Young or Marianne Alto had their hand up. I have Jeff and then Marianne.
I think the general direction with the two standing committees is a good one.
Oh, we're going to talk about substantive?
We haven't started that yet.
I thought we were.
I thought we were talking about process before we dove in.
Okay, well, other people can talk about process. My process would
process,
be
and then,
we
and
discuss
then we'll
the issues.
Item one. I'm with you, Jeff.
My only process comment is that I think it's really important when we think about what we're going to do with this, whether or not we have specific feedback today, is to situate it in the context of our conversation this morning. I think we came out of this morning's discussion agreed that we were going to do something with governance, and that that had processes yet to be completely defined, although we did have some ideas. And so a lot of this is very directly related to that conversation. I think it has to be done in tandem or as part of that process. So just to keep that in mind.
And
I wonder if just a suggestion, Your Worship, maybe a straw poll could be useful for some of them. If we're already unanimous, then we're maybe
absolutely
done with it.
I'm big on
as advisement for a future motion.
Okay.
So we are making, we're voting, we're making decisions today, or we're discussing? Or
I think what Ben said is if it's, if none of us can really figure out, if we're all really supportive of something that's already there, then we're okay with that. But
and maybe then if there is a formal motion where we 100% approve it at a future GPC, but we just move on to the next type of thing.
And my goal as mayor is to say, okay, what can we move? How can we set direction? Then we'll do it that way. Okay. But generally, the thought right now is let's talk about this, reflect on it, look for a more positive piece to go forward. Item number one is the number of standing committees. Mr. Woodland has sort of highlighted it. Jeff Young is there and wants to talk. I'm going to speak against eliminating corporate services, but I'll say why, and then so I'm on this list after Jeff.
I think it's probably the right direction. Having sat on one of the other committees that wasn't planning, I've forgotten the name. Chris would know, probably environment and infrastructure. Yeah. My observation was the meetings were infrequent, a lot of staff effort, very little discussion because the number of members was small. This structure, they used to call it Committee A and B, was, I understand, used long, even before I got on council. Back when they used to televise, I used to watch the meetings of Committee A on TV, people sitting around this table. And so there would be a planning committee and an everything else committee. The knock on it was stuff got discussed again when it came up to the next committee, but that is a shortcoming of the system we have now as well. But I think the idea of having more detailed discussion at a subcommittee is reasonable. I absolutely agree that this agenda committee, which look at the structure. The agenda, it's like the central committee of the Communist Party. It controls everything.
We're going to stop about number one. I think the agenda
which
is number.
Number 10.
It's just.
Oh, okay, I thought we were going to talk about what Rob spoke about.
So it's the one on your front.
Okay.
Yeah. Row one.
Okay. We're going to stop there.
Let's just deal with number seven.
That is all I have to say, though.
I agree with Jeff that just given the work and what the practicalities of what was happening and not happening, about collapsing community development into environment infrastructure to one would be beneficial for all. I'm not totally supportive of eliminating the corporate services subcommittee. I think that some of the tasks of a subcommittee, and as you start to get to four and mayor, that's five, that gets to be quite large. I mean, I would be really interested in seeing corporate services take on some more specific stuff that you want three people looking at, but you may not want all nine of us looking at all the time, recognizing your subcommittee's role is to identify that's really important and it needs to go to GPC, which is a different process. The current process we have, it goes to council, and then council can send it back to GPC. I think we need to be able to have the ability to refer it directly to. But for example, one of the things we do slightly at the police board is we get a list of every complaint against every police officer there, where it's disposition, that sort of stuff. There has to be limits within that, but I think there's, it's always something, so legal review, what cases are out there, where are they? I mean, our job is monitoring, is where are those, we should always get a list from the lawyers of what's going on. We understand that sort of stuff. We have to take a look at the big issues. Same with grievances, that's part of our job, I mean, that liaison. What sort of grievances are out there? I recognize at certain times, there may be some issues around bargaining that may, you know, rather than just having two people who go to whatever that...
GBLRA.
Yeah, GBLRA thing. I think the city can benefit from having more direct input from, and actually the two GBLRA people might actually be on that committee, but it's an opportunity for some of the issues to be dealt with. And then one of the bigger roles is just for those three people is to continue to work with and make sure that all of the steps around the city manager's annual evaluation is just part of that process. It's part of what we do. Police board is that group is the police chief's evaluation. Currently, that sort of resides in the mayor's office, and you know, my office is tasked with driving that and making sure it happens all the time and way. And we could have it at committee level for that. So I think that there's sort of some, not quite all nine of us should be involved every month looking at all those things, but knowing that someone within council is tasked with those responsibilities, and then obviously would bring it to our attention that, oh my God, you know, P&I is appealing and we're going to end up having to pay him $2 million, that we have those understandings. So that those are the sort of, those are my thoughts. So I think, and also given that finally that corporate services, there's whole sort of interest in participatory budgeting, and we want to get up there and talk about our infrastructure and all those sort of things, that there's an element of that to be attached to it. And again, I think it would be cumbersome having all nine of us involved in all the time. Gail?
Your Worship, I think one of the reasons for suggesting it go to GPC is that we have found that it's a full blow, because these are such weighty matters, we find that, you know, we present a full-blown deal at GPC anyway, and so we're sort of duplicating our efforts by having to do it at committee level, and then exactly the same presentation and work and number of staff, etc. When you think about it, most of those matters are matters that all of council would be very concerned about, including, you know, even if there is bargaining, and, you know, we really find that we have to circulate it because every one of you are going to have questions. And that was the main reason for recommending it more. There's probably the budget is full consideration by, you know, by GPC, capital planning, you know, all of those things would require a full presentation and a full discussion at GPC. That was sort of the thinking behind it.
Yeah, and my overall, and just I thought, my overall hope, and I don't think we structured this well, was an opportunity for the subcommittees to say, you know what, this is one that all council needs to drag in on. And don't even hear it here, send it to GPC. We didn't quite set up that structure that way, so we sort of got the trap place where we'd talk about it, send it to council, and then council would send it back to GPC. So and however we serve on that, I think there may be, I would be interested in seeing whether we come up with two committees or three committees, is allowing that committee to say, you know what, all nine of us need to be dug in on these ones. I think the two committees are planning and community development ones. So whatever way, set that up so we can just say, don't waste our time, we don't need two presentations, we're all gonna hear it at GPC, that sort of process. So however we go, but I do think there's enough higher than management, but not so high that everybody wants to dig in stuff. You're right, full budget should be in front of council. You don't need to present it twice, but I don't know, just a thought from staff and everybody else about what we could do. Because isn't there a report on we have to report on all decisions made, certain level, council, contracts were directly awarded, and all those sort of issues. So anyways, thoughts, council, you've all, some council have said on all things here, Council Coleman, Council Thornton, Joe.
Thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry, Marianne, you did initiate first.
Lisa's had a hand up
too. Okay, sorry. Chris, Marianne, okay. Lisa.
Back to item number one, which was the standing committees. It is very reflective of Committee A, Committee B. When we went through the CUF report, we have put three members of council in each standing committee, so it never had a majority of council. It had to go and articulate the reasons to the committee table or GPC or council table. Now you've got the weird scenario where you've got five members of council on each committee. So you can in fact make a decision, take it to the council table, and win a 5-4. So you just need to think through the impacts of that. And I'm not sure how to divorce this from the number of reporting advisory committees, because I think they're related. I mean, I think it's an interesting notion to have two standing committees. But then I would go the other direction and have about six advisory committees, three reporting to each one, and they'd work. So it might be, I'm not quite sure I understand the APC attached to GPC. I would put it down to that standing committee, and I would have three advisory committees to the, whatever we're calling it here, services and infrastructure. But I think the direction is to try and get the committee work attached to more of the public voice. And that's, so we have to think through those relationships, and it's problematic. I don't think we've put enough energy or time and development into the corporate services side, and I think that that's a place where we could have a public voice attached. So I'm not sure where that goes and how we do that, because this is a different model than perhaps we've discussed just in light of appointments that you made in December. So just an interesting reflection. I'm not offended by two standing committees as opposed to three, but there are some structural problems with it as well.
Marianne, then Charlene Thornton-Joe, then Lisa.
Are we doing just A1 or all of Section 8? Yeah. We're not doing all of Section 8? Okay, just on A1.
I mean, it kind of flows thin.
Yeah. I have some questions about some of the stuff that are below 1, but there you go. I don't have any issues with collapsing community development and environment infrastructure, because I think actually they're very interdependent and the issues overlap hugely. So I actually think it would be a benefit for them to be able to deal with those issues in one group, in one discussion. On corporate services, I mean, although I completely take what Gail is saying around the repetition that is visited upon staff, I actually think corporate services is uniquely positioned to provide feedback to staff before it goes to council. So in fact, corporate services deals with, amongst a variety of other things, you know, draft financial plans and issues around priorities within corporate spending. I actually think it's a great forum for a smaller group to say, looks great, don't go into great detail, as Dean says, you know, just hold that until the next meeting, next council meeting. But there's also an opportunity for there to be circumstances where someone goes, yeah, but, which means that there'd be an opportunity for there to be some reflection on that before it gets called out at the whole council meeting. So that's not definitive, but it's just an idea. And I do think that corporate services is underutilized right now, and I think there's an opportunity there. If you have a look at its mandate, which a number of us have looked at recently, it actually has a huge capacity to be helpful. And it hasn't, I don't think, in the short time I've been here, been used to the extent to which it could be. And so I almost look at it as an opportunity to grow and be more utilitarian rather than just to collapse it into the larger process, which then I think becomes a bit more cumbersome. So just kind of questions on some of the sections.
I just put on TJ, so that's what you got.
That's fine. I'm changing my mind each time anybody speaks. So awesome. Maybe I want to go through all the. Yeah, keep me a very minds. Open mind today. Very good. Could be a little empty too at this hour, but. I just think it's good thoughts of regard. So the first part, the collapsing the community development environment, I totally agree. But I also. When we have these committees, they are public, and the media is there, and especially when we're dealing with a lot of corporate things with legal, budget, and council policy, then it's a smaller group. They're having that discussion, and then we read it in the paper the next day. I'm almost slightly inclined to say that because these are such weighty, sometimes, you know, maybe the agendas might not be long, some of the issues they're dealing with are pretty substantial, that perhaps because of that, they should come to GPC. And I know it can come to the committee and we can say, let's send it off to GPC, but at that point, the report is out there, the staff have spent the time preparing for this meeting, there could be members of the public all here to hear it, and then we're saying refer it right then, and then just are left in the air until the GPC. So I'm hearing what you're saying, but I'm also, you know, I think people that were, I've taken advice from whoever was on that committee in the past and the staff who attend those meetings more to give that experience.
Thank you. Lisa?
So a new perspective, like coming as an outsider, not having been involved with any of these committees, and I know we're talking about A1, but I'm going to talk about B1 for a minute and only as much as it informs. So only convene mandate specific time limited PACs. So why not only convene mandate specific time limited advisory committees with the exception of planning and land use? So once we set our priorities for the next 3 years, why don't we make committees that reflect our priorities? Just a suggestion.
Thank you.
No, I just wanted to throw it out as a logical way of proceeding and making sure that our policy priorities are implemented over the next 3 years rather than, you know.
It's a good fundamental tenet, which is foreign policy function, right? Where your priorities set it up. Do I want seven different subcommittees? Do we have seven priorities? No. But I understand the logic of that. I think I saw Mary Ann's hand up and then Ben's.
I just wanted to remark on Charlene's comments, because the planning committee does have this experience, as its members can attest, that periodically there are issues that come before it which are evidently so huge that they need to go directly to GPC or council. But I don't think that diminishes the utility of having a discussion at the planning committee, even with the press and public in attendance, because there's an opportunity there to highlight some of the questions that are perhaps unresolved at the committee level, and to focus the discussion on some of the issues that are large enough to be community-wide in their scope and impact, to rationalize or justify why they would need to go to the whole council. So to a certain extent, I think there's an opportunity to focus the conversation at the committee level and then make a determination about whether there's a significant enough effect that it needs to go on to the whole group. And on the notion of having the community development / infrastructure environment committee, whatever that gets to be called, as opposed to, I guess, issue-specific ad hoc committees. Although these are standing committees, I do think that they have an element of providing community input, and perhaps a little bit less so in planning because it's so specific about particular applications. But I think for the potential new environment, infrastructure, community development services committee, whatever that's called, there's still an element there that people who are appointed from the community are a way in for issues that we might not be aware of or might not anticipate. And granted, we have to be careful about not diverging hugely from whatever priorities are set out because of the limitation of our resources. I do think there is an element that's important to provide some opportunity for unexpected ideas to come forward from the community, and that might be a way in. It has an agenda, it reflects our priorities, it's attached to whatever those are after we set them out. But it's also a way for those people to say, okay, let's have a conversation about this, which is kind of related to the priorities, and maybe we should thoughtfully try and construct it in a way which would be applicable to the next 2.5 years, but which might present some idea that, you know, none of us have thought of.
I'm wondering if we're ready for a straw poll.
On it.
Okay.
I have a process question.
Thank you. Oh, okay. I just want to provide a larger reflection. I remember when I was running the Association for Street Kids, someone came running in and saying, Mayor Turner's just starting to put together this Mayor's Task Force, blah, blah, on violence against women, children, blah. And if you want any money, you've got to be on this force. What was really fascinating is that was probably the first time, to a certain extent, that City Hall opened itself up, right? And from there, we opened ourselves up into public advisory. We had these PACs, public advisory committees. And the question that I think in my mind that I have is, have we gone so much further than that now? Like, so public advisory committees, the people on there are a way to give information. But for me, the civic engagement strategy, like You know, so what role do they play now? Do they have special status that they're the ones who get to tell council what to do? Or what do they do? Because how do, I mean, you know, do those six or eight people, are they the voices? So then you have to be on that committee, or you have to influence them because they can influence council, or how are we looking at that? So, I mean, I really welcome the fact that we, you know, you get the new engagement strategy we have makes it so much wider than just that public advisory committee. I mean, they're great in their day in the sense that they were the only way that you get citizen input in. We now have so much many other ways that we can do that. That I would again like to take a look at forum following function. Is there a role just to be the citizen input? Or maybe they help drive how we're going to engage citizens in regards to this issue. Might their function might change because our interests now change. I have to take a look at citizen or PACs in relation to our civic engagement strategy and where we want to go, and recognize that the PACs are directly linked to the standing committees. Anyways, that didn't help. I hope we just added some more information to muddy the waters. But I'm just trying to recognize that larger process of where we want to go as a council and how we engage citizens and what's the best model. I have an end of the speaking list, so anybody else want to speak? Thank you, Lisa.
Yeah, this is more of a process question. So, it's whatever, yeah. 5 after 3, we've been on A1. My recommendation at this point is, I notice the energy in the room flagging. My own certainly is. We could keep going. But there is a lot in here, and I think without presupposing that governance is going to be one of our priorities, even if it's not, I think one of the kind of general ideas that came out of this morning that we would form some working group, and I think the working group to look at governance could certainly take part of this and look at it. So I think there's it'll take us like at least 10 or 15 hours to go through in this itemized way. It might be good to make a recommendation to strike a committee to delve into these and come back with some recommendations, or we all go away and give it some more considered thought and then come back to this as a larger piece of the governance puzzle. That would be my recommendation, rather than kind of going through till we get to 6 and it's 4 o'clock and then we've got all these more pages to go, kind of a bigger picture approach to this.
I have Marianne and then Jeff. Sorry, I have Jeff and then Marianne.
That's fine as long as I'm on the committee.
Yeah.
And in fact, the thing I would most prefer is if I'm the only person on the committee. Otherwise, I don't agree with it. We've got the staff input. We're all going to have views on this. We're just going to have to work through it and make decisions on the issues.
One at a time, one item at a time.
Well, I think there's a lot of continuity. Once we agree, if we agree on one set of standing committees, that has implications for a whole lot of other stuff, and I think some of them will be uncontroversial. On the other hand, I do have views about public committees and a few other things that I want to express when we get to those questions.
And again, I'm speaking from my own experience. I want involvement on all of this stuff. I have to dig into them, and my experience is you can have 3 people do that, they'll come back, and then we'll be sitting going through the recommendations of those 3 people. Yeah. And they might be able to focus and help a little bit, but I suspect we're not going to save a lot of time, and those 3 people will be going all of that stuff over again. I have Marianne and then Pam and then.
I heard a second part of Lisa's suggestion, that was that given the fact that I think this arrived in our box at the end of day on Friday, and we haven't had a huge amount of time to look over it in detail. I mean, I know just looking at it for an hour raised a ton of questions for me. So I wondered if it wouldn't be a useful or utilitarian way to use our time is to take the second half of Lisa's suggestion, which is maybe we can take the rest of our time today asking questions of clarification and then go away with it and come back again. I agree with you, Dean, that I don't think a small subgroup is going to do anything other than focus it a little bit because we all want to be on the committee. But if we took a little more time to thoughtfully look through it, maybe even send some comments to Rob in advance of getting together next week or whatever, so that he could see where, if we went through each section that's yellow and said, yeah, that's okay, but this one I really have this question on, can you clarify it? Maybe our time would be put to better use the next week.
Well,
let
everybody think about that. Pam and then Shelley.
Thank you. At the risk of being labeled as repetitive, I still feel uncomfortable moving forward with this when we're missing 50% of the story, which is the engagement and the comments from the people who are on those, you know, not just the standing committees, because those are council committees, but who are on the other advisory, the actual advisory committees. And I think my observation over the years has been that advisory committees that are application-driven are extremely successful, mm-hmm. and the ones that aren't, we've struggled with. And I think the reasons why those struggles have occurred, there's a lot of input that we could be getting from those advisory committee members. And I think it's extremely useful to have the staff's observations here, but what I would like over here is the observations of the folks who've been on those committees or have engaged with those committees. So I'm reluctant to move much further along in here, because again, are we going to be asking for input after we've already kind of charted our course in some way? And I think it's so important to engage with the folks who have really given a lot of their time to these committees. And I know with the Public Planning Advisory Committee, I'm so embarrassed about that committee and how they have really tried to do their job. I don't feel that we supported them in the way that we should have. And we get some very interesting feedback on that as well. And we changed from the model of the Advisory Planning Commission, which again was application driven, although we could also refer draft policy to them, to the model of the Public Planning Advisory Committee. And I think you would get feedback on that. You know, what have you gained? What have you lost by going to that? So again, I'm just feeling uncomfortable that we're kind of moving along, and this is all about public, and we haven't heard from the public.
Good. Shelley?
Well, I agree with Pam with what she's saying, because I think it's critical that for something to succeed, we have to have buy-in. And this is buy-in from the public on the advisory committees. And if they're going to buy in, they have to be involved at the earliest stages to understand why we've moved forward. Otherwise, if we move forward without that buy-in, we've seen what will happen. It's happened over and over again in the last 3 or 4 years, where it just doesn't work. So I think we're racing forward without getting the buy-in from the stakeholders at the earliest possible stage.
Chris?
Thank you. and thank you for the reference to Mayor Turner and the expansion of advisory committees. There were some before that, but there was certainly an expansion, and I don't know if it was hyperbole, but at one point when we were doing an assessment after the fact, they said there were 140 or something advisory committees. I don't know if that was the case or not. There were lots, and we pared it down, and then we pared it down again under George Cuff. but we never got away from that sense of frustration by the members of the advisory committees that they weren't getting stuff that they could meaningfully get their teeth into unless it was application driven, as Pam says. And I guess the advisory committee that I saw work the best for a number of years was the Downtown Advisory Committee, when it had a budget of $1.5 million from the sale of Broad Street that they were allowed to use for marketing purposes for downtown. And because there was a relationship of their initiatives to a budget allocation to then see some initiatives move forward, it became really meaningful. That should be a useful thing to reflect. And I thank the mayor as well for bringing up the notion of, we've had PACs, maybe they moved to something else. As we go through the spectrum of public participation, and we've moved arguably from, we're going to inform you of what we've done, I hope you like it. We haven't ever said we're going to the other end of the spectrum, which is direct democracy, but we're doing something collaboratively in the middle. It means that the public advisory committees also need to move down that scale so they're ahead of the public, and maybe that is the role they have then in carrying on the community engagement part. In specific areas. So, I mean, I think it's an interesting discussion, but I think it takes a lot more work. I agree with Pam. I don't think we can make decisions now, and I don't think we can even go to straw polls, frankly, because I don't think there's anything that can be taken off the table.
So perhaps we can, in the thighs, we leave it with these two thoughts. Form should follow function. How we set up should follow what we want them to do. And perhaps the larger question is, what would be useful to you, council? That's the question. I mean, this is about doing for the city, doing its work better. What I'm saying is, don't just open it up because you want to appear open or that sort of thing. Because I think that's been part of well-intentioned that we have these groups, but then we never really had anything to send them. And then we went through the terrible thought of, well, do we then try and find busy work for them? and we were too busy to find busy work. You know what I mean? It's sort of like, let's make full, real use of them or find another use. And so those are important questions. It's difficult. We can no longer all gather around Centennial Fountain and every day throw clay tablets in. It's a direct democracy of what we're going to do today. I mean, there's many, many, many decisions that have to happen. It's, you call it parliamentary, I'll call it representative democracy.
Yep.
And some things we completely leave in the hands of the citizens, and some we make decisions on. That's our job, making some decisions. Sometimes decisions, let them make decisions. Those are our roles. So perhaps we can take a look at this, and if you could have the two lenses, hopefully not doing it, is to say, as I look through this and look at changes, what's going to help me as a counselor, or what I think is going to help council as a whole make decisions? And given what's the function that I want them to do? Because it might be fun just to blow it all up and say, here's the seven priorities. We have a harm reduction subcommittee. We have a homeless committee. Whatever, you know, those things. And that's the task focused one. And we've had some good experience around the bridge. We had good experience around late night task force. A lot of the ones that we said, give us a committee, go to the work, you do it, you report back, you die. That those also had great references.
Could we have a committee on governance and invite people from UVic and invite people from ex-parliamentarians and ask them to participate and work in conjunction with us on this? This affects us in a huge way, all of the residents of the city, you might actually add, of the region. So to strike a committee on governance might be potentially a successful one to engage, this would be a task-specific committee engaging the public and seeking out, maybe actually having discussions on who we need to be on that committee. What type of skills do they need to have to in order to help advise us and guide us through a reorganization of our governance?
Well, I mean, okay, so this is where I think that all of council could benefit from either being reminded or get the information is, like, we've hired consultants, we've gone through a lot of consultation process around governance, specific around land use and that whole process. We did a governance review at the beginning of last term. We should basically understand what the problems we tried to fix 3 years ago, some of the solutions. We probably fixed some problems and created new ones. And then that at least would be a starting base of where's the next steps to move forward on. And then as that is, do you bring this larger group together and bring in
Is anybody else's emails inbox full this morning as soon as this came out? Like, I must have gotten 25 emails about this document.
Didn't get a thing.
You didn't get a thing? Wow. Okay. Check when you get home. Maybe they're just delayed. So anyhow, that's all. I'm just wondering if that's not indicative of...
What was the distribution for this document?
Typical public meeting distribution.
Yeah,
I mean, going forward, we need to be balancing what council's needs are in terms of governance and getting good information to make good governance decisions and the limited resources that we have. I mean, we'll support whatever we can afford to support, and when we get to that limit, we'll let you know that we need more resources. So. We approach this exercise not from is this whole system broken? Certainly the recommendations you're hearing from staff are, we think we can make some adjustments to it. Our observation with the public advisory committees are consistent with what the mayor and Councillor Coleman have said, which is, despite the best form, we're still not getting enough out of them. The members aren't that happy. Where there are the application-focused activities seem to work very well. Planning department has good relationship. It works. But we have a couple of them that are withering on the vine from sort of lack of care and maintenance. And we need to figure out, well, how do we reinvigorate that?
Thank you, Marianne.
Just following up on a couple of comments, I think, prior to our priority setting session, we're getting sort of an information session on capacity and existing work, I guess, that's going on already. And maybe as a part of that, it would be useful, since governance seems to be of interest to everyone, that we could get a bit of a review on the governance work that's happened in the last 3 years, so that we don't reinvent the wheel. I think there's governance stuff to do, for sure, but let's not do the stuff that we've just done.
Thank you. Ben?
I think there's different types of recommendations in here that might be worthwhile to deal with distinctly. I think all the questions around the PACs could be hived off and dealt with in some way in consultation with the PACs, or a selection of their members, or maybe a delegate for the co-chairs of each PAC. But everything else, I would almost favor us dealing with somewhat expeditiously through a fairly ruthless exercise of Robert's rules. If no one wants to move any of these, there's nothing to be discussed, and it's a nice recommendation that we take no action on. It sounded like we had a consensus around merging sort of one, the very first part of the first recommendation. So in a future meeting, we could deal with that in a minute. And sort of, and we could also have a way of tabling or referring recommendations that need a more full discussion. So, but to do credit to our administration that put this together, I don't think we can devote the next 5 months to sorting some of these out. So I think maybe we need a 3-hour meeting to barrel through as much of the least contentious, sort of deal with the low-hanging fruit. And some of those will be substantial reforms that might not require much discussion. Merging standing committee, one that I'll throw out that's later in here, keeping our opportunities for public input in our ordinary meetings intact. I'd like to just discard the suggestion of doing away with question period, with all due respect to Rob and our city manager. I think there's the administration might see value in it, but I think it's important in holding us to account and allowing someone to throw a zinger at us with no notice. So to deal with these very detailed and valuable recommendations, despite whether we agree or disagree, I've sort of gone through each and put an X and a check, perhaps mm-hmm. even collating how all 9 of us, where our X's and checks would lie, would give Rob a good idea.
They're different.
You see, I want the opportunity to try and change your X into a check.
Yes, well, you can, and Robert's rules or another process would allow that.
I guess what I'm really going to reflect on is I sort of see flagging by council, or we're done. Perhaps we will say, let us look at, take this, again, those couple of suggestions, don't let perfect be the enemy of good, form follows function, what's going to help us get our job done, with those in mind, read through these, we'll look to schedule another meeting. I think we can actually go through most of this in 3 hours. Right.
And then put the PAC question after. Once we decide how we're going to...
It's always a good question of, do you put the really meaty one first, true, because that's the one you want to spend time on, as opposed to get through the 1,000 easy ones at the beginning, but you're too short on the meaty one because you ran out of time, versus it's nice to get a sense of completion, you get something done, and look, we're on a roll, and let's keep it going. So,
and until we know how our SCs are structured, the standing committees are structured, that would largely, I think, inform.
So, I think perhaps that's the direction. I don't know when the next date we've got scheduled for the next jump.
We can certainly try to schedule something in the next couple of weeks. Part of the budget sessions are scheduled due to conflicts with other things, so we may be able to sneak in this. I'd like to get direction on this one way or the other, sooner rather than later, and whether that direction is go out and consult with everybody, you know, that's fine. It's easier for me to get that going and then get it back to you so you can determine what the structure is, and then we get on with business. So I'll try to schedule this in the next 3 weeks. It might have to be on a special days with time set aside just for this.
There's certainly an opportunity, and Shelley, if any of those emails you think are relevant to the rest of council, I'd love to take a look at them. But certainly an opportunity as you go through that to also talk to the various bases or people who say, what do you think of this with this? And there's an opportunity for it, again, in your mind, because it's not just talking to the people who have been on PAC or PAC, but there's other people out there involved and that sort of stuff. Okay, so with that, I think then perhaps we might
want another question.
Lisa.
So that's where I was going.
In the meantime, as well, I can pull the electronic version of George Cuff's report, and you can understand more fully the things he fed back to the council and at the time he worked here.
Thank you. So with that, motion to adjourn. We'll see you in the hall. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Thank you.